Hey everybody, I'm Dr. Richard Stevenson, and I'm the Director of Education at Stevenson Dental Solutions. I'm also Emeritus Professor of Clinical Dentistry at UCLA. And this is our teaching center where we conduct many hands-on courses all year long. Hey, now before we get started, I'd like to make a brief introduction about a product that I personally use to manage my practice. It's called CareStack. CareStack is an all-in-one cloud-based platform designed for the U.S. dentist that wants to run and manage their business without the need for multiple software subscriptions to put pressure on your bottom line. CareStack provides all of this functionality to run the contemporary dental practice in one cloud-based solution. If you'd like to learn more, scan this QR code and book a brief demo with one of their specialists. Thanks, CareStack, for sponsoring this channel. So today we're going to cover the full gold crown preparation on the Kilgore Typodont. This is the 28 tooth Typodont that they make. And a lot of schools use this. This is the advanced standing dentist burr kit, which I really like. And this is the RGS-3. And the opposite side of this instrument is the RGS-4. These are all critical tools to complete this project. Notice how there's a little bit of space in the normal Typodont equilibration. On the lingual, it's pretty socked in, but on the facial, there is some opening. So when you're finished, you're going to see some space there. Remember, this is A, B, and C planes. When we reduce the occlusal, we're going to want to pay attention to that factor. Also, notice this bulge on the facial. It's pretty huge, and if you're not aware of this bulge, you may end up creating an undercut on the facial. So we need to remove the majority of that bulge when we're finished and respect the secondary plane that needs to follow different than the functional cusp bevel. So the lingual side is pretty much straight up and down. Let's take a look at this diagrammatically. This is the B plane on the facial cusp, the C plane. And then we, of course, create this A-plane. The A-plane is also known as the functional cusp bevel, and this is an integral part of occlusal reduction. When we complete the outline of the buccal lingual, you can see that there's a primary plane in the gingival area and a secondary plane that follows the outer contour of the tooth. I like to divide this into what I call the retention zone, and then the upper part would be more like the contour zone. We're going to want to establish a 6 to 10 degree taper. I like to use a little bit of the Stevenson Dental Solutions Blue Putty Pack. This is a addition silicone, which can be used to create a stent before we prepare the tooth so we can compare back to this. This is used on most of the United States board exams for the graders to check your work. Some dental schools are not teaching this. I'm not exactly sure why. I think it's an excellent way to teach consistency in your preparations, and it is clearly something we use clinically often to verify adequate reduction. So what we do is we just place it on the tooth and make it sort of smooth, and then what you can do is you can establish a fiduciary mark on the occlusal that'll tell you exactly where the forward area is so you don't get confused later on. So I just take the an instrument like the RGS instrument and just make a little arrow so I know that that is the forward facing direction of this when we go back to check the preparation. So after this sets, we're going to remove it and then we're going to section it right down the middle of the preparation. You could also do it mesial distally, particularly if you made two of these, and we'll use this later on to verify adequate clearance. One of the burrs you can start with is the 837012. This burr measures 1.2 millimeters along its cutting surface. It's a parallel cylindrical burr, so it does not have any taper to it, and it's pretty good for making cuts to keep in mind how much you've reduced. You know, notice that the end of the burr can be used as a measuring tool to see that you're reducing 1.2 millimeters. Of course, this is not enough for a crown. We need to have 1.5 millimeters or more. We're going to use this to do the initial preparation following the natural shape of the triangular ridges. So this goes uphill and downhill and uphill and downhill as you're reducing across this B plane. And we just repeat the same procedure for the C plane, keeping the burr parallel to the inclination of the cusps on the lingual side. We don't want to flatten them. We want to maintain this morphology that we see in the natural cusps. If the burr gets clogged, just use a diamond cleaning stone to get it refreshed. So once the B plane here and the C plane here are reduced, we notice that the cusps are pushed out facially relative to their arrangement with the teeth mesial and distal. So now we're ready to create this A plane or this functional cusp bevel. And it needs to follow the opposing buccal cusp incline, that lingual incline of the facial cusp on the upper. And so this angle will be reproduced while we reduce this aspect of the preparation. It must be emphasized that this procedure right now is a critical part of occlusal reduction and occlusal clearance. This is not an afterthought. This is not something we do at the end of the procedure. This is something we're doing while we're preparing the teeth to get those cusps lined up. And you can see that we can obtain the clearance that we need by reducing the facial cusp appropriately. Let's go ahead now and move on to the axial. And for that, I'm going to use the 878K012. This is a tapered burr, and the widest portion is 1.2 millimeters, but the tip is only about 0.6 millimeters. We want to line the burr up along the line of draw of the preparation. So it's going to be tipping slightly towards the lingual to be perpendicular to that curve of Wilson. Now this tooth has a really bulbous facial surface, so you notice that we're going to have to reduce a lot of tooth structure in order to get the burr to engage that last little gingival area for the finish line. So don't be surprised if this requires a lot more reduction than you might expect. We're going to then use the burr following the same line of draw to prepare the lingual surface, which I think is a little bit easier because it tends to be on one plane and fairly straight. It's the facial that is going to be more complicated because we're going to need to establish a secondary plane on that facial. Let me just show you from the lingual view how we would establish the approximate location of the finish line, which of course is a chamfer. Actually a modified chamfer with a rounded internal and a declination angle of approximately 60 degrees relative to the horizontal. We're going to want to prepare the facial so that we engage the interproximal with the same burr and not hit the adjacent tooth, but move the burr further interproximally until we end up having a very small segment to remove with the next burr. So be careful here not to hit the adjacent tooth, keep the burr inside, and establish this type of look. When we're here, we can now switch over to a needle burr. In this case, I'm going to utilize the 859010, which is a millimeter wide at the top, and the tip of this burr is very narrow. It's about 0.45 millimeters. And we're going to be able to break through the interproximal by just gradually moving the burr uphill. You see it goes from the lingual to the occlusal, and we just sort of march along, creating this little escalator, this little staircase that just keeps pushing itself towards the facial, leaving a little shell between your preparation and the adjacent tooth, so as not to mar the adjacent tooth. The finish line is not ideal at this point. That'll need to be corrected in the next few steps. This facial secondary plane needs to be lined up with the buccal groove of tooth number 18 and follow the tooth in front of it, tooth number 29, and that occlusal portion of the facial surface, which means that you're going to be leaning it more towards lingual than you did with the initial preparation. So this creates a secondary plane. So now it's time to refine things and fix your finish line with this 877 or 8877. I'm just using the 8877 here, but you could use both of these spurs. They're the same shape. One just refines more than the other. So I'm just using this to create some refinement of the functional cusp bevel, which had become a little narrow, and also just to take off some of the rough spots on the occlusal. You can use this in high speed, or you can even turn it down into a slow speed if you have a friction grip attachment for your slow speed motor. Or you could alternatively use electric handpiece and turn this down to about 5,000 RPM. Notice how this diamond has got the optimal shape for a modified chamfer. It provides you with that 60 degree declination angle and a slightly rounded internal line angle. Notice how we have two different planes on the facial plus the functional cusp bevel. You can see them clearly here. We can check now with our putty to see if we have accomplished adequate occlusal clearance of 1.5 millimeters. Can't always do this, but it's helpful. So after finishing a few more minutes with some polishing abrasives and even some hand instruments, this is the final preparation, which does mimic the original shape of the tooth and I think provides us with a decent full gold crown preparation. You want to be somewhere between 1.2 and 1.8 millimeters of occlusal clearance, and that will make this Typodont tooth a little bit short because it is a little bit of a shorter tooth to begin with. Anyway, the final results here. I appreciate you watching this short video on the full gold crown, and I hope that you stay tuned for more videos. Let me know what you think in the comments.